Bruce DuMont back, and nice to have you with us. Malcolm Buck is listening to us in the great state of Maryland. Leslie Donahue is also watching, and Christine Romedy is also joining us this evening. And we've got Johnny in El Paso, Texas, who's tuning in, and he's got a question. But I want to ask you a question before you ask me, Johnny, what you asked for. You're from Texas, so I want to get your reaction to Governor Abbott's decision to open up the state of Texas. Are you supportive of that or not?
Since we're on the radio, I'm going to be kind.
Okay.
I think he is on another planet.
On another planet?
He is putting the whole country in jeopardy. I made the whole state, rather. I could say a lot of things, but we're on radio. I'm not happy at all. I don't support what he's doing at all.
Okay.
And not talking politics, talking being human.
Okay.
He's going to put next Wednesday, he's going to, here in my town, I don't think that a lot of the business leaders are going to just stick with the program and not mandate the employees or themselves to wear masks because this thing is not over.
Uh-huh.
And so already Alison has changed their mind about doing it. And so, you know, we'll see. But no, I don't think I think he needs to be primary. I think he needs to be replaced.
Do you also blame him for the recent weather and electricity related issues in Texas?
I don't know enough about that. I've been hearing about this ERCOT situation. I don't know, was he, because this happened roughly 10 years ago. You know, probably know about us in El Paso. We didn't get hit with that. You know, we were lucky enough to be with the Western Grid. But anyway, I don't know enough about it, but I wouldn't be surprised that, you know, a lot of them always, they have this attitude in Texas. I'm talking about the government, that they don't want any thing from the feds, but the minute something goes wrong, they have their hands out, you know. And I noticed FEMA came down and right away helped us out, you know. But anyway, I could go on and on, but I don't want to go ahead.
My other question to you before you ask me the question that you were going to ask, El Paso obviously is a border town with Mexico. And my question to you is, the recent announced changes of the Biden administration as it relates to illegal immigration, do you think that is going to or has it already affected life in El Paso?
Not really. I may have told you in the past that I am a retired CBP officer.
Uh-huh.
So I was down there in the middle of it. You know, I worked. Of course, I've been retired quite a few years now, but I still have contact with my peers, you know, my fellow employees, and we talk back and forth. And no, I'm looking at the human side of it. I don't think that, I think that right now Biden's doing the right thing. And then already, Abbott is already lying, saying that they're bringing the virus here into this country, but they're not. They're being checked and they've been tested, and then they're being released to family if possible or being sent back.
Now, but where, Johnny, where is this happening? Because obviously there are those that oppose it that say the people that are coming into the country should be checked for COVID. I have not read nor have I seen any evidence that there are places where people are actually being tested before they are brought into the United States or put into some sort of a incarcerated area down there waiting further processing. So are you telling me and telling the audience that there is a medical official that is checking everybody coming into the country? Certainly we can't say that everyone that's coming in illegally is being treated, but if they're coming through the central input areas, are you saying they are being tested there?
It is my understanding. Again, as I told you earlier, I'm out of the loop now.
Okay.
I don't check in, but I'm just going by hearsay and by what I think and what I believe, that those who come through the port of entry, that's another thing. They were talking about this wall business.
Right.
People come into this country illegal on airplanes and cruise ships and you name it, whatever, another story. But I'm thinking that those that have been, matter of fact, a lot of them are looking for officers to take them in and to process them because they want to be brought in right. But now the ones who are coming in illegally, I don't know. But the ones who are coming through the ports, as I understand, they are being checked, being tested before they are released out into the community. That's what I'm hearing myself.
Mark Costello, are you hearing that through your progressive, you know, literary sources, that the fear that those coming from South America or Central America are being medically, at least there is some medical intervention before they are allowed in the United States?
Like you, I have not seen written confirmation of that, but I would assume, given our I would hope that those protocols are in place.
Nick Com, what about you? I mean, this is one of those issues that you know, is likely to keep you know, illegal immigration on the front burner of American politics for the next couple of years.
Well, I think the idea of whether or not they've been vaccinated or have been tested to be COVID-free is the least of the concerns. I mean, it's basically the surge that we've seen in unaccompanied minors, exactly contradicting both Trump and Obama policies, I think, is a much bigger issue. And again, you know, apparently fences don't work unless they're around the Capitol against some specious right-wing threat.
But why would that be the least concern if people from Central America are coming to the country and they're not being tested by our medical officials? Why would that? I would think that would be one of the main concerns.
Well, look, we are vaccinating people like crazy. The cases are stabilizing. We're heading towards that dreaded term that we weren't allowed to use for the longest time, but now can, and that's herd immunity. Yeah. Again, I'm not totally dismissing the issue of whether or not they're being tested or not, but there's plenty of people in this country who haven't been tested. And frankly, if you don't have symptoms, most people who don't have symptoms these days aren't getting tested themselves.
Julia, if people are coming into this country illegally, or legally or illegally, should they be tested in some way by U.S. Medical facilities, at facilities?
We're definitely getting a handle on the COVID crisis. And, you know, I don't know how to respond without being condescending to what Nick just said about herd immunity. I feel like asking, come on, you know the answer to the question of why herd immunity is different when we're approaching it with vaccination versus by just letting everybody get sick. I mean, I don't know how to not be condescending when you say something that's so, you know, apparently non-attentive to the facts of the science here. But yeah, I mean, of course, we need to be careful with COVID. And I think that the Biden-Harris administration is being as careful as they can. And that's why some of these facilities are getting reopened. And, you know, it's not awesome, but I'm not ready to criticize what the Biden-Harris administration is doing yet. Mm-hmm. I think that, you know, we definitely need to address immigration in this country. We need to amend our current immigration laws. We got 59 votes in the Senate in 2012, I think was the year, when we tried to get DACA passed. 59 votes. We damn near got bipartisan support for DACA. So, you know, let's get that over the finish line. Let's make it happen in a humane way.
All right.
And let's stop having these fights that we don't have to have.
Got to pause. 1-800-723-8289. More from Texas when we come back. Bruce DuMont back. Thanks very much for joining us tonight. 1-800-723-8289. And I have asked for people who live in the great state of Texas to call us and let us know what they think about Governor Abbott and his decision to open up the state. You know, when Republican governors do things like opening up a state and ending mask mandates, you can bet your neck that not only will Democrats be upset with it, but the national news media will be upset with it, and they will go after every Republican governor and beat the hell out of them. Because they're doing something a little bit different than what the federal government wants. Bob is listening to us in Houston, Texas. Bob, thanks for joining us on Beyond the Beltway. You're a longtime listener. Nice to have you with us this evening. My question to you is, are you happy or sad with what Governor Abbott is doing in your state?
Well, Bruce, thanks for having me on tonight. And actually, I'm very happy with what Governor Abbott has decided to do to relieve the mask mandate. It's been a long time coming, and a lot of Texans are looking forward to it. I know I am, as a live music fan. My friends and I are looking forward to getting back out and enjoying live music again.
Now, everybody is saying, not everybody, but at least the D.C. pundits are saying, they had all of the experts on this morning saying how horrible it was, what a bad idea it was, a reckless idea. Obviously, the president referred to it as Neanderthal thinking. And, I mean, the national media was pouring all over Governor Abbott and the other governors who've made these decisions and suggesting that people might be just irresponsible down there in Texas.
Well, Bruce, we have a saying down here in Texas that goes like this. Those people saying all those negative things are all hat and no cattle. In other words, they don't know what's going on down here in Texas. And the people of Texas, for the most part, we've always have been very independent. But at the same time, we've been very self-reliant and self-sufficient. And we help each other in times of crises like this. And we're looking forward to the mask mandate to be lifted effective on Wednesday. And to be honest with you, a lot of us wearing masks the past year has not really affected the way Texans have gone about and lived their lives. In March, Houston was pretty much a ghost town, as was Austin. And I travel back and forth from Austin and Houston an awful lot. And by May and June, things were pretty much getting back to normal. More people were still working at home. But as far as going out to restaurants when they were open, going out to other places that were open, we all followed the social distancing guidelines. We all wore our masks, and we all did what we should be doing in times during a pandemic.
Will you be doing that later this week? I mean, when the mask mandate is lifted, what are you personally going to be doing?
I'm going to be doing pretty much more of the same that I've been doing all year long. I'm a caregiver, and so my dad lives in assisted living. So I've taken a very cautious personal take on this whole thing because I'm not necessarily worried about myself getting sick, but I don't want to bring anything to my father or anyone in his community or any of his caregivers. So I've taken a very cautious take on this all year long. Now, when I go out and do exercise in the parks, I don't wear a mask. There are plenty of people out there riding bikes, running, walking, wearing masks while they're exercising. I choose not to do that. And I don't wear a mask when I'm driving by myself in the car. If I have to take a ride share, yes, I will wear a mask. But come Wednesday, I'll be doing pretty much what I usually do. And that's just taking a cautious
What is the situation? As I recall reading recently, Texas is one of the lowest states in the union insofar as the distribution of the coronavirus vaccines. Why does it appear to be taking so long in Texas, if indeed you believe that?
Well, Bruce, I can only talk from a little my personal experience with that.
Sure. Right.
As I mentioned, my father lives in assisted living. Yeah, but everyone in his community has been vaccinated. All right, so everyone in all the residents and staff members and caregivers of his community have all received their second dose.
Mm-hmm.
I, on the other hand, am a little lower down the totem pole as far as eligibility is concerned because we're still doing the first responders and people like that as well, you know, healthcare workers, as well as people over 65. However, this is the one thing that surprised me. Last week, I got a text from Methodist Hospital telling me that I am now eligible to receive my vaccine. And I'm nowhere near age 65. And I don't have any kind of pre-existing conditions that would make me eligible. But what they're doing is that, and this can be verified on Harris County's website, where I reside in Houston, Harris County, that they are servicing. If you have a relationship with a hospital, which I do, I have been a patient of Methodist. My general practitioner is affiliated with Methodist Hospital. So I got the notification from Methodist by text, and it's an individual link. only for me. I can't share it. That is allowing me to be able to take advantage of getting my vaccine. So I don't know what really has, why all this negativity and why people are saying that we're lower on the list, because I know a lot of people that have received their vaccines, and now that I'm in Generation X, a lot of my Gen Xer friends are also now getting notified that it's their turn to take the vaccine.
Bob, I want to thank you for your call and the input on that, but I want to bring you into the conversation we were having in the last segment and ask you to weigh in if you care to. And I want to bring it back to Julia Klein, who's with us, because before the break, I asked her.
Oh, good. Hi, Julia.
And she is, one of the things that she does is she offers advice to young people who are entering the work market, and gives them advice and counsels, I guess, companies as well, as to how they should operate in the Me Too era. And I asked her if she would be giving some advice to young women who might be listening to the program this evening, as well as their bosses. I mean, what's fair game now, and what is absolutely verboten, Julia? And I ask that question to you, knowing that Bob comes out of the business community, and I'm not accusing him of anything, but I'm sure if he's in the business community in the state of Texas, he might have heard of or seen actions that were okay with him or no big deal to him that probably might cause you to pull some of your hair out. So your reaction?
Well, everybody in workplaces needs to recognize their the places of privilege and places of power that they stand in. Mm-hmm. I have privilege as a white person. The other four of you have privilege both as white people and as men. All of us have privilege as being able-bodied. We all have privilege as being native English speakers. And each category that gives us a power and a privilege means that we, relative to others who lack that element of power, element of privilege, it means that that person who lacks that power and privilege can sometimes feel blown over or disregarded or not heard by us. And so everybody in workplaces, and it's especially straight, white, Christian, able-bodied men, but it's not exclusively, because they occupy the most categories of privilege, need to acknowledge that the ways that they used to behave have very likely never been okay with a whole lot of people. And so Cuomo, for example, Andrew Cuomo talks about, you know, he's gotten a lot of criticism over this photograph of his two hands on the woman's face as he's about to kiss her. And his defense of that is, there's photographs of me doing that to all kinds of people for all kinds of years. That's not a defense, Andy. That's not okay. That's never been okay. And what needs to happen is that everybody needs to acknowledge that the ways that we have always operated have probably been unintentionally, sometimes not, but very often unintentionally, hurting others, making others feel discounted, making others feel excluded. And it's on those of us who have elements of power and privilege to examine ourselves and to restrict our behavior and say, what might I be doing or saying or assuming or taking for granted that is in some way disadvantaging someone else who is not like me?
Julia, let me ask a question, and then I want our other guests to sort of weigh in with a specific question for Julia as well on this subject. Okay, Julia, I'm 76 years old. Okay, I'm going to be 77 in a couple of months. I'm 76. I'm a grandfather. I have four grandchildren.
Congratulations.
Thank you. Is it okay for me if a woman walks down the street or is serving me lunch or whatever, is it okay for me to call attention to how attractive I think either her clothes are? I probably wouldn't say it about her, but I might say it about something that she's wearing. Does that make me a chauvinist pig or what?
The best way for you to self-examine that question in every instance is ask yourself, if that person was male, would I say the same thing? Yeah. If that person was unattractive to me, would I make the same comment? If the answer is no, I'm saying it because, frankly, I think she's kind of hot, then no, it's not appropriate and you should keep your mouth shut. That's the answer.
Are attractive people then second class citizens now in the workplace?
I think it's like a non sequitur. I don't know what that means.
Okay, when we come back, I'm gonna elaborate on that. I also again I'm gonna include you, Bob, if you have a question of this, because you've been in the workplace a lot in the last 20 years of your life. Mark, you've got a faculty friends to deal with, so we'll come back and talk about it. Don't go away. Bruce DuMont back on Beyond the Beltway. Thank you very much for joining us wherever you're listening, from coast to coast and border to border. Mark Casello is here. He is a professor of English at the Calumet College of St. Joseph. That is in Michigan. Nick Kalm is the executive with his own firm called Reputation Partners. Julia Klein is a progressive author and also has her own website. Not website. She has a website, but again, her own podcast. And that's Me Too. Give us the name of the podcast again. Me Too.
The podcast is called Solving Me Too, and the website is the same.
Solving Me Too.
Solving Me Too.
Brent Hambachek joins us. He is with Human Events Magazine, and we've got a caller on the line, Bob from Houston. And before the break, I'm gonna start with you, Mark, and I wanna ask you I admitted some things about myself. And ask the question of what's proper and what's not proper in this day and age. Is there anything that you have questions about as to what you might be able to say, and whether or not women would view that in some way as being an assault of some kind, a verbal assault? Turn your computer on. You can't admit anything if you don't turn your computer on.
There you go. Plausible deniability.
Yes.
You know, prior to being in higher education, I was in the business world. And, you know, in my interactions, what I've always tried to do, and hopefully this aligns with sort of what Julia is describing, is begin with respect for the individual. But certainly, you know, from the time I was a young man to today, values have changed. And even as a professor in the classroom, there's a vigorous and ongoing discussion about treatment of gender identity, respect for assault survivors, sensitivity to students' situations that just weren't in the conversation even when I started teaching back in the early 2000s in higher education. So to answer your question, you know, or to throw it to Julia, you know, sort of what about language of group categorization? I know that a lot of times in business, you know, people say, okay, guys, we're going to do this. And you've got that kind of gendered language. Do you have any recommendations for professors or business people about how to avoid that kind of communication?
Yeah, that's tough. And I'm guilty of it sometimes myself. You know, I often, you know, I use the phrase ladies. I network with and am friends with lots of groups of women. And I often say, I refer to folks as ladies. And I've received the feedback, especially from younger women, that they find that to be pejorative. And so I've taken in that feedback. And I'll say also, Bruce, to your earlier question about, you know, making a comment or touching, it's mm-hmm. certainly not exclusively men. A couple of years ago, I'm somebody who says, oh, I'm a hugger, and then I'll give someone a hug. And a male friend of mine a couple of years ago said, yeah, you know what? You never wait to, like, I'm not a hugger, and that's kind of not okay with me. And I thought, oh, okay. And it doesn't make me a bad person.
Right.
It doesn't make me an evil monster. It just means that it sort of like gave me like a new thing. Like mm-hmm. I kind of didn't realize that some people don't like to be hugged, even though I think it's terrific.
Right.
And now since then, I've just sort of had a mental note. Don't lunge in for the hug. And that's what we're asking everybody to do. And I see Brent shaking his head with disgust over there. And I don't know if I even want to invite what it might be, because I certainly don't want to fight, because you and I have friends from way back. And, you know, I know that you're a good person. I'm baffled at how.
Well, let's go to Maya. Why are you shaking your head, Brent?
I'm baffled. Look, this conversation to me is, I mean, I don't have any questions to ask, because frankly, the topic is almost offensive. I'll tell you why. We've had a great debate within religion for thousands of years about whether or not sin lies in thought or in deed. Well, what we're attempting to do today is to say that sin lies not in thought or deed, but in implied or attributed thought or deed.
Well, that got Jimmy Carter in trouble. He lusted after women.
Look, no. we're saying that somehow or other, just because of who I am, I'm inherently privileged. I have inherent signs of racism, all of this. Frankly, I think it's offensive. I think it's garbage. I don't buy any of it. I won't accept it. I think it's morally wrong. It is not the way I raised my children to think or see the world. If this country is so horribly racist, we have a lot of questions to answer. Why do Asian Americans do better than white Americans? Why do Indian Americans do better than white Americans?
No, but we're dealing with gender issues right now.
I want to go to
Nick, because we're talking about gender at the moment. And my question to you, Nick, is because you work in the professional
field.
Talk about
white privilege.
Yes, white privilege is certainly part of the discussion. But I want to go to Nick because you also work in the professional field. You're supposed to help improve people's reputation. I'm not going to ask you what you would suggest to Andrew Cuomo right now. But again, what would you say to a client of yours that has been the recipient of a Me Too attack that has gone viral? What do you say to him?
Well, it really depends on the circumstance.
Yeah.
I would say, you know, and to bring it back to Andrew Cuomo, I mean, I think, you know, just with somebody like him, I think the smart thing for him to do would be to take a temporary leave of absence, you know, because this is going to continue. More women are going to come out of the woodwork. Even in his own rather pathetic defense, he said, I've kissed hundreds of women and some men too. So
right. It's
basically, now we're going to get a parade of other people who've been made to feel uncomfortable. Far more so, Bruce, than your example of complimenting the waitress on her outfit or if she's wearing some jewelry or something like that. What Cuomo has basically admitted to, this is the part that's so galling to me. He at first chalked it up to mentoring and to being a friend to the employees and then saying that he's done this hundreds of times, he's admitted it. Mm-hmm. And then he's just gonna go, I'm not gonna step aside, I'm not going anywhere. If you've done something like this, if it's clearly a transgression, as it has been in his case, you can't just keep powering on and expect it's gonna go away. Now, it is a different thing because he's a Democrat. If he were a Republican, the media and the Democrats would be all over him. To Mark's excellent point in the first hour, national politicians on the Democratic side of the aisle have been largely very silent on this thing, so they've given him a pass.
Bob Meehan, I want to go back to Bob Meehan. I want to just see if he wants to weigh in, then I know he's got to move on. But Bob, is there anything that you've heard in this discussion that reminds you of circumstances that you've encountered in the business community that you've operated in for much of the last 25, 30 years?
Oh, most certainly, Bruce. And Julie, you brought up some very interesting points about the whole Me Too argument. And I'm really kind of perplexed by the whole thing, having been in I had my career in sports and entertainment marketing and sponsorship and fundraising for those events. And, you know, encountering so many different people throughout that industry. And whether it's sports music or if it's in the corporate side with corporations doing sponsorships, I've had so many, as a man, okay, I had so many Me Too moments with women and with men. And to me, I find it rather kind of laughable at times, because if I were really to come forward as a man, you know, that time in my 30s, 40s, or 50s, saying that so-and-so female harassed me in such and such a way, I'd be laughed at, okay? Even so, I'll throw this out there too, is that, you know, as an openly gay man and involved in the LGBT community, work-wise and philanthropically with charities that I support and serve on, boards for, I've had plenty of Me Too moments with men, and I find it kind of ridiculous because some of these men are married with children. Some of these men were in very big positions of power, whether political people or if they were in other industries where they have some type of a power, like the legal profession, or in the music industry, or in the sports industry. So,
do you think your situation is unique, Bob, because you've been operating in Texas? Is there a higher level of acceptance in Texas because of the macho image of the state and cowboys and everything else?
I wouldn't go that far and kind of, I wouldn't bring in any type of that so-called hyper-masculinity argument into it. I think that Texans have more of a live and let live attitude towards a lot of things. And, you know, we get a bad rap for, you know, being rednecks and you know, rather intolerant type of people. But that's not necessarily true. Texans are very quite the opposite of that. And if you get to know a lot of us, then you'll definitely experience that. In the work world, most of my experiences were from people who don't live in Texas. So if I'm dealing with people from the sports industry or music industry, these are people from L.A., New York, Nashville. Okay, sporting is the same way. All right, these are people outside of Texas. Some of the political issues are, you know, some of the politicians I've encountered that had my little Me Too moments with, some were Texas politicians, others were on a national scale. So it just runs the gamut. And what it comes down to is, you know, Bruce, you know me, I am a diehard Deadhead, Texas Deadhead here. And in the Deadhead community, following Grateful Dead, we have a saying called Be Kind. And it's just basically a simplified version of the golden rule as we go down the golden road.
So we've got we've got to say goodbye because we're out of town. Deadhead, right. You're deadhead down the dead road. I'm Bruce DuMont, back shortly. Bruce DuMont back on Beyond the Beltway. Thanks very much for joining us. 3 months from now, Brent Hamacek. Will Andrew Cuomo still be the governor of New York, in your opinion?
Wow, it's a great question. And so now I turn into what appears to be a coward. I'm just being honest. I have no idea, and I have no idea for the reasons I said earlier, and that is there's no way to predict how strong this will get, how virulent the hatred around it will get, and there's no way to predict just how hard he'll fight. He's not a typical character. So he's not likely to go quietly into the night. And when you put these two things together, this gathering storm around him with his personality, what's the old irresistible force and immovable object? I have no prediction. It's going to be fun to watch.
Nick Comm, you have been in some very tight public relations messes over your career. Your job is to get people out of those messes. In 3 months, will Andrew Cuomo still be governor of New York?
I think it depends on how deep the cover-up on the nursing home deaths is. I think if anything is going to drive him from office, it's going to be that. And even the possibility if there's an indictment there for obstruction of justice or some other appropriate federal level crime.
Does moving fast on that issue, on the nursing home issue, does it erase the other issue?
If that gains any more traction, I think that's what's going to drive him from office, not the sexual harassment activities that he's apparently guilty of.
Mark Casello, will he be in office 3 months from now?
Yeah, it's difficult to say. I was looking at the governor's website, and I noticed there's just some crisis communication, pushing out new policies, putting the attention on governance. So I don't know. I think there's a lot of information not yet known, but like Nick said, I think it's the COVID related cover up that's really the threat.
Julia, he is not likely to get any extended period of time to go and have that introspection that you have recommended earlier in the program, which may be good for him personally, but politically, will he still be a viable governor 3 months from now?
I think it comes down to the politics of who his replacement would be. If we remember, Ralph Northam, the governor of Virginia, was accused, was found to be accused of wearing blackface a few years ago, and there was a big call for him to resign. And in that situation, had he resigned, his second in command, Justin Fairfax, I believe is the man's name, would have elevated to governor. But it was discovered immediately in that, in the wake of that, that Justin Fairfax had been accused by multiple women of sexual assault. So the Democratic Party was like, oh, shit. Pardon my language. Oh, shoot. You know, we go from Northam to Fairfax. We go from blackface to sexual assault. This is not a step in the right direction. So the Democratic Party just decided to, you know, take their lumps and ride it out with Northam. And also he stuck his, you know, he's stuck in his heels. You know, and I wanted to respond to Nick saying earlier, I don't think that it's fair to say that the Democratic Party's response to Cuomo is purely partisan. I think we have to acknowledge that, you know, back in Franken's day, the Democratic Party went after him with ferocity. And we've had a whole bunch of experiences since then. And I don't think that that people in general responding a little bit less ferociously to Cuomo, I don't think that's a bad development. I don't think that, I think it's doing it at a disservice.
Tell that to Brett Kavanaugh and his family, Julia. Tell that to Brett Kavanaugh and his family.
That's one of the experiences that we have all had, right?
For someone watching this story from afar, which is the vast majority of people watching the program and listening this evening, how important is it that one of the women who made the charge, one of the early women who made the charge, is running for political office now? Does that give her story more credence or less credence? In your view, Julia?
Neither. I mean, what gives this credence, you know, Brent said earlier, there's no evidence of any of this. And that's just so false. I mean, first of all, we have the sworn testimony of five different women. That is evidence. Now, that's not infallible evidence, but if it was a court of law, which this is not, which is an important distinction, that would all be entered into evidence. The women's statements is evidence. And also the fact that all five of them have said that he did things very similar. That is also tends to corroborate the credibility and the truthfulness of what they're saying. You know, there were other men on the Me Too hit list who, for example, pleasured themselves into a plant. And that was the allegation from numerous women. And so men have MOs when they behave this way. And so the fact that all of these women are coming out with the same basic, he asked me about my dating life, he put his hand on the small of my back. The fact that all of the women are saying the same things tends to corroborate all of them. And one of them, the second accuser, Charlotte Bennett, actually told her boss, Cuomo's chief of staff, less than a week after it happened, and she was transferred. So that also is strongly corroborating the credibility and the truthfulness of her allegation.
If someone is listening, if a young woman is listening to the program this evening and is going into the world of politics, what advice would you give her if she finds herself in a similar circumstance? Because that circumstance is something that I would think you would probably agree is fairly prevalent in the world of politics.
It's prevalent in all worlds. I don't think that it's more in politics. It's across everything. But number one, you need to have an arsenal of succinct statements like stop it or that's inappropriate. You know, be able to use your words. Women have a responsibility to use their words. Second, if anything ever happens, write it down, email it to yourself, tell somebody, don't stay silent. Because the fact that these women, in many cases, have told somebody at the same time is significantly corroborating of the truthfulness of their story. The third thing is just be really firm in your boundaries and know your value and understand that you don't, you know, and if it's happening to you, it's happening to a lot of people around you. So open your mouth, talk to people, don't be afraid, you know?
They know.
Don't.
Say no and say no and say it frequently and loudly.
That too.
On that note, Julia Klein, thank you very much. Give us the name of your website and your podcast again.
The podcast is called Solving Me Too. And the website is solvingmetoo.com.
Okay, thanks very much, Brett Kavanaugh. Brett Hamachek, thank you very much for joining us for Human Events Magazine. Nick Cobb, thank you very much for Reputation Partners. And again, Mark Casello, thank you very much for joining us as well. Our thanks also to Connor McKnight, our producer who made this program possible. I'm Bruce DuMont. Good night from Evanston, Illinois.